I went to the
yeah.
I did.
You always
thought
you.
Yeah,
I
know.
I need to see you,
Dave
Steffens. And I said, okay,
how about
yes.
We got Jim Rogers. We got Tommy Lloyd. And then they got
Senator
Henson. Are you looking at all your Wayne Jaska signatures?
Yeah. You bet I do my part with him. I don't know for sure. I know my brother.
How many
you did. Faster than I did.
Good job. You didn't swallow.
No, I didn't swallow it. You might have to
take it for $1 or do you?
Mr. Walls, can I stand here for a
second? I guess you may.
Just write it off.
No,
it's fine.
And all the
time. I
gotta
tell you,
you gotta see your chaplain.
I didn't get it. Oh my God, I'm over to you.
William?
Yes?
Did you find my tripod?
Your what?
My tripod.
I didn't look. You know?
You got it.
He comes with WSB radio. Rachel's having a tripod in.
Good, good. I can tell that radio voice there.
What, the little one?
Yeah.
Who bought it? Not me.
But hey, you know what?
How do y'all doing?
Hey there.
Still appreciate you being here.
Oh, are you Parker Wyatt?
Yes. Yes. Great.
You
keep an eye on shit for him?
Absolutely. Right? I did contact Ryan, and Ryan didn't do it.
Oh,
there
you go.
But I need it.
Chris Joyner. Come in. Hey, how are you? Nice to see you.
I don't know.
Yeah. That was Ashley.
I didn't have it. But now I have it. I feel like you should have seen it. You haven't gotten one yet.
Hey, how are you? Good to see you. Welcome back.
How are you? Parker Wallace is trying to call the Brian Hussing.
Really?
Yes,
sir. It's not what? Well, James Salter. Salter just got back from Spain. He was here for, I don't know, 7 or 8 days.
Good to see you again.
William, please. Mr. Perry. I can sound like my dad's in the room or something.
Yeah.
So I'm calling you 60 seconds.
In 60 seconds?
No, I'll call you. I'll call you for 60
seconds. Oh, okay. Got it.
What Georgia watched does. Why is it
important? Got it.
Why is it important?
Got it.
You're not looking for 60 seconds. You can fill a box.
Senator Henson and Senator McCoon here, and Senator Henson reminded me, he said, see, the Democrats were first on ethics reform and the Republicans came in later. We're completely joking, as we will throughout the night. We're extremely excited to have both of them here, because as we've talked about from the very beginning, and to quote Julianne Thompson of the Tea Party, this ethics debate isn't a left versus right issue, it's a right versus wrong issue. And fortunately, enough people across the state are getting together and making sure that our elected officials know which side is right and which side is wrong, So those who have been fighting for ethics reform for a long time are finally starting to get some partners in their fight. And groups like ours that have been fighting for ethics reform for so long are getting partners in our fight. And I can't tell you, this is the ninth of these nine town hall meetings that we've done across the state, and it has just been incredible. The momentum created by the primaries this summer with the question that was on the ballot, and all the work that has been done literally for decades is really starting to pay off, and we're really getting somewhere. And I keep telling my nonprofit friends and my lobbyist friends how excited I am about the upcoming legislative session, and they think I'm crazy. But I think as soon as we get there, they're gonna see the momentum. So now that I've said all that, I'll tell you, I'm William Perry. I'm with the Common Cause Georgia, one of the members of the Alliance for Ethics Reform. I first wanna introduce a couple of our partners that are represented, and I'll let them tell you a little bit about their group and why ethics reform is important to them. And then we'll kind of walk you through a little bit about the history and the fight we've been up against with the Alliance. I'm then going to turn it over to Senator McCune to talk about the legislation that he's currently drafting and working along with the Alliance to draft. And then turn it over to Senator Henson, who we were just talking about his legislative history, has been around a long time and is going to share thoughts on, again, what ethics ought to include. Because our goal from the very beginning, Lenscap, sorry Eric, I can't pass that up. Our conversation from the very beginning was about how this was gonna be an open dialogue. We're inviting everybody to the table. There's no winners and losers that are willing to come forward and talk about what ethics means. And after getting beat up for so long, we're going for broke. And we're gonna get significant ethics reform passed in this state if it kills all of us. So we're ready to go. And so we wanna introduce two of the partners in that fight that are with us tonight. So we'll start off with Kelly Persons from the League of Women Voters.
Come on up here. Hey everybody, thanks for coming out tonight. We really appreciate it. As William said, this is nine of nine, so we hope to make it a really good last of that. My name is Kelly Persons, and I'm with the League of Women Voters of Georgia. The reason why we are here and part of the Ethics Alliance is that it simply fits within our mission. Our mission is to encourage the informed and active participation of citizens in their government. I hope all of you got a little citizen's handbook that I passed around earlier. I think I missed a few of you, so feel free to flag me down. And part of what we want to do is make the tools ready and available for citizens to where they feel comfortable to speak out on whatever issue it's here. So part of that is being here so you can know what the issues are. You might not know that there is an issue with ethics down at the Capitol until you're sitting in this room and hearing all of these stories. Some of the other things that we're pushing for that I'm sure Senator McCune will get to is things that would help make the citizens' job easier. Right now we expect them to be able to go to the State Ethics Commission and look up their representative and judge for themselves as to whether that representative was unduly influenced or not by their lobbyist. But we know that that system doesn't work. It constantly crashes, you hard time getting that information. So part of what we're doing is just making it more available for the citizen to conduct that role that we expect them to play in a democracy. So that's why we're happy to be part of the Ethics Alliance, and we're happy to keep pushing this issue forward. So thank you all for coming.
Thank you, Kelly. Next, Carla Johnson with Georgia Watch.
Hi, again, I'm Carla Johnson with Georgia Watch. I'm the Grassroots and Outreach Director for Georgia Watch. And some of you may not know about Georgia Watch, but Georgia Watch is a nonprofit, nonpartisan, statewide advocacy organization. We fight on issues that affect a person's quality of life and their pocketbooks. Some of our key issues are home foreclosure, ethics, identity theft, access to justice, access to health. Those are our primary issues that we focus on. But tonight, we are here to talk about ethics reform down at our state capitol. You know, ethics is not a partisan issue. In fact, It's an issue that Georgians across the state, across party lines, have said that we need strong, supportive ethics reform down at our state capitol. And we are here to stand arm in arm with our Ethics Alliance and say, yes, we are going to do everything that we can to ensure that there are strong ethics reform and meaningful ethics reform down at our state capitol. I'm happy to be here with Josh McCoon, Senator Josh McCoon, and Senator Henson, who I've worked with at the state capitol before, and I can vouch for Senator Henson that he is one of the good guys. And I do want to say there are a lot of good guys down at our state capitol that have the political courage, but you being here tonight will give them that extra boost of energy to go and have meaningful ethics reform. I'll be here the remaining of the night, so if you have any questions for me, I'm happy to take them as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. As I said, to give you all a little history and perspective on the Ethics Alliance, this will be our third legislative session officially working together as an alliance. One of the main issues that I'm sure a lot of you have heard about is the $100 gift cap. Common Cause has been calling for that $100 gift cap, pretty much standing on our own since 2005. And a lot of people say, well, $100, that sounds like a pretty high gift cap. But again, we've been pushing it since 2005 and hadn't gotten it yet. So we're continuing the fight, and a few years ago, once everybody started realizing what kind of fight this was going to take, we decided we've got to all start working together. We can't divide and conquer, we've got to work together to really keep running into the brick wall long enough to spin around.
No, please go behind where the microphone's.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
So, the radio guy's asking.
I hear you. Since 2005, and so running into that brick wall, but finally starting to feel that wall give by the collective strength that we've been working for. So 2 years ago, going in now to our third legislative session, Common Cause got together with the Georgia Tea Party Patriots, the Georgia Conservative in Action had been a longtime partner working down in South Georgia, and of course, as you've heard from the League of Women Voters, and Georgia Watch. People that you can say represent all sides of the aisle. We're all nonpartisan, but I think we have groups that have been brought together that represent the whole spectrum. Because again, as we've said, it's not right versus left, it's right versus wrong. And as the fight continues, again, the momentum continues. And we first started in the session of 2011. We came up, sat down at the table, and came up with all the ideas we thought would give the state a big boost and raise our ethics laws to the level we needed. We came together with a 26-point plan, and perhaps we were a little naive, but we thought if we tossed it out there, that some would pick it up and run with it. Maybe there'd be a one bill for one part of the plan. Maybe somebody would do the complete comprehensive plan. But that year, no one really stepped forward and took it. And I'll say there were some bills from the minority party that would have helped that year, but of course they couldn't get the legs with the Republican Party firmly in control. I give the disclaimer that that was Senator McCoon's first year, and we fully expected folks that were coming in that year to kind of get their sea legs and figure out how the legislature works before they push for strong reform. But that year we were joined at our kickoff press conference by Senator McCoon and his partner from across the aisle, Senator Jason Carter, to talk about how they were newly elected, but it didn't take them long to figure out the disconnect that happens between the people in their district and the people that serve under the Gold Dome. And so although we didn't get a bill that first year like we had hoped, we did get momentum and start to figure this thing out. Coming back last year in the session of 2012, we did get a majority party bill in each house. We had lots of Democrats willing to sign on it, but very few majority party members. The Senate actually did pretty well. Senator McCoon was able to get some of the leadership going. Senator Henson and the Democratic caucus answered with some extremely strong bills that are part of what we're going to be talking about this year. So there was the bipartisan, I guess, appetite, if you will, that had been existing a long time that was finally beginning to come together. And so after last year, after we got bills introduced on both sides, but very quickly realized they weren't going anywhere, Why? Because the Senate leadership allowed the Senate bill to get assigned to the Rules Committee. The House leadership, or Speaker Ralston specifically, decided to let that bill, instead of going to the Ethics Committee, the Ethics bill going to the Ethics Committee, it too went to Rules. And those who have been around the Capitol for a little while know that's a kiss of death. If it's going to Rules, you're probably not going to see it. And we didn't see it. No committee got to vote on it. No committee got even a discussion on it. They wouldn't even hold a hearing on it. So there was not a single discussion about ethics reform the entire session. And that's when we collectively decided we can't just regroup next session. We've got to take the fight out there to folks across the state. We've got to make sure that people are able to get involved in this and make their voices heard in an important election year. So with Senator McCoon's leadership on the Republican side, Senator Henson's leadership on the Democratic side, we're able to convince both state parties to put a question on their ballot about the gift cap. And so whether or not you picked up a Republican ballot in July or you picked up a Democratic ballot in July, you got to answer yes or no, should we stop the practice of unlimited gift giving by lobbyists to legislators? And Georgians answered with a resounding, resounding answer. 72% of Democrats, 87% of Republicans, combine the two and it's 83% of Georgians. 1.2 million Georgians voting in the primaries said, yes, put a stop to this. And you can focus on the one question being about lobbyist gift caps. But overall, I think, as it was for us, that was the marquee issue. Many Georgians would say, yes, limit the lobbyist gifts, but let's go beyond that. And that's what our coalition has constantly talked about. Gift caps is the marquee issue. It's easy to understand. Let's take it from unlimited giving to a limit of $100. That's easy to understand. But we all understand that legislation is complex. The problems with our ethics legislation are extremely complex. So it goes well beyond a gift cap. And even just talking about the gift cap, we started this pledge so that we'd have one piece of legislation that laid it out as clearly as the questions on the ballot did. We started asking candidates to sign on. We went down the last session, the last night of the legislative session last year, and actually stood in the hallway with the big board and was asking for candidates to come by and sign it. And we ended up with about 6 or 8 after that first night. We thought, well, we're not gonna stop. We're gonna go back again. When they qualified for office, we went down there and we stood outside where every candidate for the General Assembly had to come in and sign their paperwork, and we again asked them everybody to sign it. Senator McCoon was one of the first to sign it. You see Senator Henson's name awfully high on that list. When folks like that started signing on, when leadership in the Senate started signing on, that started the momentum. And so that helped carry that vote through the session. Because if you would have asked us by the time it was over, when we started this pledge board and we had 6 or 8 people at the end of the session sign it, that we would finish the primary campaign season with 130 candidates signing on, we would have never expected it. But that's what happens when you don't wait till the next legislative session. That's what happens when you take it out to people and start talking about it and making it a campaign issue. We're extremely excited because after the November elections, of that 130, 50 people still are standing and are going down to the Gold Dome and have agreed to be co-sponsors of that legislation. I guess, full disclosure, we have to knock it down to 49 because one of our pledge signers did resign, as y'all may have heard about. There's going to be a special election to fill that seat, but we'll again make it an issue in that special election. So that leaves us where we are. We've built this momentum. People of Georgia across the spectrum have answered resoundingly saying this is what we need. And so our last step was to take it out again, like we did with the candidate signatures, like we did with the bus tour that went to 14 cities in 3 days around Georgia, telling people about the vote for the primary. We wanted to step up again. So we've gone to 9 cities around Georgia, held these town hall meetings, talked about the plans, and we've solicited input for those plans. And believe it or not, when you actually open up the dialogue, you put it out to people, you actually get some good ideas. And we've already had three things come from those town hall meetings that we're exploring to add to the list, because Everyday Georgians stood up and said, this ought to happen. We said, that sounds like a pretty good idea. You look at that, what we're doing, in contrast to what's happening, particularly in the House. Senator McCoon and Senator Henson both sit on a special study committee for the ethics, for the Senate, to look at ethics. They had a meeting up in Athens this past Sunday during the legislature's biennial, and they allowed people to come in and listen in on that meeting. Over on the House side, they had a similar meeting, but didn't allow anybody in. It happened behind closed doors. We're told that future meetings of that committee are going to happen by conference call. No one's going to be allowed to input with that. And if it's anything like we've seen in the last 2 years, any slightest change to anything related to ethics is going to happen like that behind closed doors. It's going to get shoved through. There's not going to be a hearing. There's not going to be public input. And you'll just get what you get. So that's why we've got to stand up. The Senate is taking the lead on it. They're showing how it's going to be done, and that's why we've got the momentum to get something really important. And so I just wanted to kind of frame the history of where we've been, why we're so fired up about this fight, but also why we're going to remain fired up, because it's just something that we can't stand for anymore. We've got the momentum. We need your help to get it. And you know, people keep kind of coming in these sessions, and this is about the average crowd that we've had at these town hall meetings. And it goes without question that when we, you know, open it up for questions, somebody says, how can we fill the room? And quite frankly, we haven't been worried about filling the room for these events because we know we're behind it. I mean, we know people are behind it, and we're going to be able to call on them when we get there. But I take great satisfaction in two things that I've read since the last legislative session. One, by a state senator who represents, each Senate district is about 195,000 people? 175,000 people. A state senator said, on most issues, if he gets three phone calls from back home, that sways him on a particular issue. Representative Ed Lindsay, who is the majority whip, continues to be the majority whip in the House, recently at a forum that I attended, said that his rule of thumb for a long time has been, if he gets two contacts by an informed, knowledgeable constituent in his district, he knows that there's an issue out there. If he hears from four, then he knows there's a problem. If he hears from eight, he knows that there's a serious problem. If he hears from a dozen people in his district about an issue, he knows that there's a crisis that demands immediate action. The bar of public engagement and public trust has gotten so low, it takes maybe three people in a Senate district, maybe a dozen in a House district, to move us forward on that. I can guarantee we can find that. And with y'all helping us, and with y'all helping us connect in our networks, we're not worried about this room being filled. We're worried about the product we produce from having this meeting, from moving it forward, and then going from there. Because I guarantee you, y'all can help us get three or four people in each Senate district, a dozen in each House district, or whatever it takes. I think we can far exceed that list. So the fact that y'all are coming to give us input, the fact that our friends in the media are here to help us tell the story, is the momentum we need to move it forward. And I'm telling you, that's why I can't wait. I'd like to skip over Christmas and start this legislative session tomorrow, because we're going to have a lot of fun and we're going to get somewhere. So these two guys are wondering if he's ever going to shut up. And so now I am. I'm going to turn it over to Senator McCoon, let him tell you about some of the legislation he is drafting and filing. I want to turn it over to Senator Henson to talk about what he feels and his party feels needs to be added to the conversation and the priorities. And then once they've said it, had their say, we want to turn it over to you. Get your reaction. Are our priorities right? Are we talking about the right issues? Is there anything that needs to be added to or missing? Is there anything you need to know to help us move forward on this? Is there anything we need to know to make sure we get it right? So without further ado, I'll go ahead and turn it over to Senator McCoon and let him get started.
Well, thank you, William. I appreciate the opportunity to be here with you this evening. William and some others have made every single one of these. This is my seventh of the nine town hall meetings, and they have been extraordinarily valuable. He's given you a pretty good historical perspective. There are a couple of points I'd like to make and then talk specifically about some of the proposals that are out there on the table, and then I'll turn things over to Senator Henson. I do want to say, coming from my perspective, this being my going into my third year as a state senator, when I got elected, I got the advice that I think was dispensed by some over the weekend at the Biennial Institute, which is you spend your first 2 years, you sit down and shut up and listen. And I guess, you know, one out of three isn't too bad. But you know, 2 years ago when I was campaigning, I, you know, thought this issue was important, ran on this issue. After being elected, got familiar with the Ethics Alliance, and I think it is important to underline the nonpartisan or bipartisan nature of the coalition that is behind ethics reform. This is not an issue of right or left. This is an issue about the elected officials in Georgia delivering honest government to Georgians. But 2011 and the 2012 legislative session were not very kind to proposals that had to do with ethics reform, as William said. We couldn't even have a meeting to discuss them. But I can no longer say that that's the case, because on Sunday afternoon in Athens, we had a meeting of the Senate Study Committee that Senator Henson serves on, as well as myself, as chaired by Senator Crosby, and our incoming President Pro Tem David Schaefer serves on that committee, as well as Senator Renee Unterman. And we had a very good meeting to discuss specifically a proposal dealing with the gift issue, which, as William rightly noted, is not the only issue, but perhaps the one that is most identified in the public mind with the overall concept of ethics reform, and probably symbolizes best of all what's wrong with Georgia's ethics laws. So we've made a lot of progress in the sense that now we find ourselves having open meetings discussing this issue. We find ourselves heading into this year's session with the incoming President Pro Tem, the incoming Majority Leader, and the incoming Chairman of the Majority Caucus all having been co-sponsors of the ethics legislation that was introduced in 2012. I do think that, broadly speaking, there are four areas that we are going to look at next year, two of which I've pre-filed constitutional amendments on. One of those has to do with the funding of the commission, and I always get the name of the commission wrong. I know it's no longer the Ethics Commission, but y'all know what I'm talking about. And I want to say, before I get into how we do this, this was an idea that was championed by the minority caucus. This is nothing new, but I think it's a good idea, and I think it moves the process forward, and that's why I wanted to put that proposal front and center. And it's a constitutional amendment that will dedicate funding to the commission. For those of you not familiar with the history, in 2006 and 2007 in particular, the commission was very aggressive in enforcement actions. They hired investigators, they closed cases, they fined folks, they penalized folks, they did what they're supposed to do as an agency. And their reward was to have their funding cut by over 40% in the intervening years. It's not appropriate, in my opinion, for those who are being regulated by the agency to be determining on an annual basis how that agency is going to be funded. And so I think that the people of Georgia ought to have the opportunity in 2014 to weigh in on this and decide if a fraction of 1% of the general fund should be designated to allow the commission to do its work. When you think about it, the commission is statutorily obligated to audit filings that are submitted to them right now, the filings, if you just think about it as every incumbent and not the idea that there are people also challenging the incumbents for these offices, you're talking about somewhere between 4,000 and 5,000 public officials who are expected to file with the Ethics Commission. And you have something like 12 employees at the commission who, in addition to, you know, keeping the lights on and maintaining the filing system, are also expected to do this auditing duty and a lot of other duties as well. And they simply don't have the staffing, and they certainly don't have the technology available to meet all that is statutorily required of them. So I think that funding measure is going to be very important. It's something that will merit a lot of discussion and debate next year. The second constitutional amendment has to do with additional tools in the toolbox to investigate allegations of corrupt behavior. In 2010, then State Representative Austin Scott introduced a measure that would empower the Attorney General to impanel a statewide grand jury that would have broad investigatory powers to look at instances of corrupt conduct and fully vet those before issuing indictments. But it would give our state's chief law enforcement officer, I think, a critical tool in being able to pursue those kinds of allegations. Third, of course, is the gift limit. I do want to just give a little background on that. Georgia, one of only three states in the entire nation that has no regulation whatsoever on these gifts. I think that's a crucial point to make, because for us to be in this minority of three, and the explosion of spending for the last 3 years, that which has been disclosed, we've seen it go from $1.4 million to over $1.8 million. And the point was made at a session we had in Athens on Monday night that if that was spread over the entire General Assembly, it'd be about $10,000 per legislator. But those of you who review these things understand that it's certainly not an even distribution. And so there is an enormous concentration of monetary value being showered upon a very small population within the General Assembly. And I think that leads to a lack of trust. I mean, we've seen it documented time and again. I think there was an article in the Atlanta Journal-Constitution recently citing some polling data to that effect, that the public, particularly on the transportation issue, doesn't trust its elected officials to spend these funds the way that they say they're going to spend them. And so I think when people ask, why are these various reforms important, the answer is that we have very big challenges. I'm sure Senator Henson would agree that we have challenges in the areas of education, health care, criminal justice, transportation, infrastructure. There are big issues facing the state, but we're not really, in my opinion, going to be able to grapple with those issues until we're able to show the voters that we're worthy of their trust. And that's what enacting serious ethics reform is really all about. The final one of these four measures is really a comprehensive catch-all legislation, and it might wind up being several different pieces of legislation, but I'll give you a few examples. One has to do with our revolving door policy. As a state legislator, if I exit the legislature, I am forbidden from lobbying the state for a 12-month period. And you may wonder, well, why is that? And the answer is, you obviously don't want someone in office making decisions about the law, and at the same time negotiating a deal with someone to come back and lobby state government. It presents a clear conflict of interest. Well, we need to make sure that those who are in the regulatory areas, who are in the state agencies, are subject to similar restrictions. We also need to look at personal financial disclosures. While they're required of state legislators and they're required of certain other members of the executive branch, it is important that that be broadened so that people understand the financial interest of those on various boards and commissions that make big decisions that determine how state dollars are allocated and how state resources are spent. Another issue, and then I'll wind up, and perhaps one that doesn't seem as serious on first blush, has to do with these local officials that were dumped into the state filing system. We have members of county commissions, members of city councils, and members of boards of education who in my view are just trying to do their job and do it as well as they can, who have been put in a situation where they try to file into this system that we have with the state that was never designed to handle the thousands and thousands of filings that now occur during these four or five times of the year that we're all filing our campaign disclosures. And as a result, you're finding people in some cases who don't raise any money at all find themselves fined by the commission because the system crashed and they physically could not log into the computer system to be able to make their filing. Now, those of us who are in the General Assembly who are running fairly sophisticated campaigns, I think we can be expected to take that week of time that we have and make sure we file and file on time. But for these literally thousands of local officials, I think we've created a real mess. And so I would propose that we restore the local filing officer arrangement that existed for years, allow those folks to file with their probate judge or the head of their Board of Elections, and then let that individual be the one to upload those filings. It'll take a big stress off the system during filing week. They can then file later. We maintain the statewide database, but we do it in a way that doesn't create a gotcha situation for a lot of our local folks who simply aren't, were never really intended to be the targets of some of these laws that we have on the books. So I think those things are going to be important. We haven't introduced a comprehensive bill or pre-filed a comprehensive bill because, as William said, we wanted to conduct an open and transparent process. We wanted to go around the state and give people the opportunity to be heard. Well, we've done that now, and we're going to continue to do it tonight. And then it's going to be time to sit down, do some hard work, put all these different ideas together. I'll mention one more while I'm thinking about it, and that has to do with open records. The General Assembly has, passed various open records laws over the years, including last year, but we always seem to find a reason to give ourselves a blanket exemption to that law. And I think it's very important, if people are going to get an accurate snapshot of state government, that we need to have an open records law that reflects that. And so that's something that's very important to me and something that I'll be looking into as well. So we're going to take all this information, we're going to put it together, hopefully in one comprehensive bill or a few different bills if we need to, and get those filed so that we can begin a discussion that will address all of these different issues. And I'll close by saying this. You know, a year ago it was a struggle to get anybody to file ethics legislation. This year it appears that there's going to be a lot of ethics legislation. I get an email every day from another member of the General Assembly saying I'm dropping this bill or I'm dropping that bill. And that's great. It should expand the conversation. But it does mean that all those of us in office and those of us in the public that have an interest in this are going to have to do a very good job of separating the wheat from the chaff when it comes to what kind of legislation is out there. Because the worst possible thing we could do would be to pass a bill that in effect did very little and just moved on about our business. So I'm looking forward to to next session as well. I don't know that I want to skip Christmas, but I'm excited about it. And I do want to thank Senator Henson and the minority party in the Senate, because they have brought forward lots of important ideas. They have championed this issue, and it's going to be my pleasure to work with him and with all the members of the Senate to make sure that we lead on this issue next year. Thank you.
We should give that a round of applause. And you can also tell, I'll stall a little bit while you change your batteries, that we're turning up the heat. Isn't it getting a little warm in here?
Yeah.
We're turning up the heat on the issue, so we're excited about it. And one thing we can't control is the heat in the room, but we are all going to control the heat down at the Capitol, and it's going to be a lot of fun. So I'd love to turn it over to Senator Henson and hear from you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it, and I appreciate the comments that Senator McCoon stated. He's been courageous on the ethics issue in the last couple of years, and been very proud of the way he stood up, not only on the ethics issue as far as the gift cap and some others he's mentioned tonight, but on issues that affect individual senators, the senator from the 9th and those hearings. He tried to do the right thing, and regardless of what others might have thought, and I was very proud of him. We've come a long way. Common Cause has been there for years working on ethics. I know I've been involved in politics a long time, and I hearken back to the 1990s, but even before that, in the 60s, you know, you could take your campaign money when you finished your election, you went home, take it as income. That was done away with. Later, in the early 90s, Pierre Howard and Common Cause, which you had a Blue Ribbon Commission like in 91 or 92, I think Pierre Howard worked with you at the time, started doing things. I remember when I ran for office in 90, you know, as far as campaign gifts, Medical Association Georgia gave Zell Miller $100,000 campaign contribution. There were no caps. Pierre turned out a $50,000 campaign contribution. So we passed $3,500 cap in the early 90s. There was no reporting on any gifts from lobbyists. They said we should have been in the legislature when there was the railroad fights with in the 60s. But at least we got disclosure and reporting of gifts. You know, that helped a little. But it's very obvious that the confidence level of the public has never been weaker as far as how they view their elected officials and their trust in government. And we need to do everything we can to restore that confidence. That is why we had previously put bills that had a gift ban or a gift cap, trying to move us toward a more ethical environment and one that has the trust of the public. We certainly would have liked our bills to pass, but I'm very proud of Senator McCoon for moving forward with his bill and getting support now of the majority party on various issues. You know, the gift cap bill that he had last year had some things that we thought were possibly loopholes. Not that it would have not been a move in the right direction, but I've talked to him in the ethics committee the other day, talking of things about possibly making sure lobbyists, you don't have eight lobbyists, get together and give $90 a piece and give somebody an $800 ticket, you know, things like that. One lobbyist is repeatedly doing things, maybe even annual caps. But the idea is, you know, I certainly felt he was very receptive of looking and studying each of those issues to get to the true goal, not being what has happened at times in the past where the legislature played games and we try to create their gift windows of gift. I know in the reporting ban in the early 90s, there was an exemption for any Georgia product. So there was an alcohol distributor down in Columbus that produced alcohol in Columbus. They could give you two cases of vodka as long as it was produced in Columbus and not have to report it. So those kind of loopholes, which may still be in there, by the way.
And now we have Kias.
Seriously, you could have gotten a Ford because of the Georgia product. You know, those kind of loopholes are, you know, the details that need to be really studied and really evolved to protect the citizens. And I think Senator McCoon is trying hard to try to address those. I know that members of the Democratic caucus are committed to those types of practical solutions that prevent those kind of loopholes and make ethics something people can believe in. I'm glad he mentioned today the funding. Senator Lester Jackson last session introduced a bill that was similar to the Alabama model that had a certain percentage of state the state budget going to the Ethics Commission. So we wouldn't see the kind of politics of an Ethics Commission chair afraid that they took on a powerful legislator or the governor would have their budget cut. You know, certainly there were concerns not that long ago when the governor weighed in on the Ethics Commission and a possible investigation on him. We'd like to see that as independent as possible. We have another bill, and after hearing today that Senator McCoon is looking at the funding issue, and hopefully you'll work with Lester Jackson and get him involved in that on yours, and maybe you can sign his. We hope that we'll look at an independent ethics commission. Senator Stoner last session, I believe, had a bill that would have made the ethics commission appointed by members of the state Supreme Court and Court of Appeals judge. There's other ways you can do it. You could have, you know, certainly we start with having a seek a common cause on the Ethics Commission by virtue of their position as Director of Common Cause. But there's ways to
make
sure.
Let's give him a hand for that.
there are ways we can make this independent and not just a commission appointed by the governor, because political influence then can be involved, and that's something we're trying to remove. The $100 gift cap certainly is an important goal this session, but I don't want to lose sight of those bigger things. Neither do I want this session to be a point where we in the legislature feel like we gave something to our public and hold back future improvements. So I trust Senator McCoon, and I know my friends in the Democrat caucus will keep making sure that we're moving in the right direction, even if we get something done this session. So I'm not going to belabor this anymore. I want to say that I'm very happy to see you all here. We talk about the 3 or 12 constituents. I mean, if you get one constituent calling you, you're waking up and paying attention. And you're the individuals here from the media or from associations and groups that have people out there, or citizens that are going to reach out to their friends, is a really key element in this. It's often easy just to say, oh, there's no real problem, and then take your $170 ticket to a Falcons game or whatever. But unfortunately, those relationships sometimes do cause some members of General Assembly to be influenced. But more importantly, it tarnishes the perception of the public on whether we're acting in the interest of our constituents or the interest of these lobbyists or special interest groups. And I was also, one last thing, and Senator McCoon might, if he's asked questions, he brought up, we talked about registered lobbyists. And he's also, I think, looking at making sure that definition, we always worry when, lobbyist comes to eat with you, well, you bring somebody else who's not a registered agent, and they buy the dinner, or they buy the golf bag, or they take you to the resort. The people are, it's more what their purpose is, what their effort is to be. And I think he's looking at language in his bill to make sure that we protect against those kind of actions as well. So. I will leave it open to questions, and you, William, and thank you very much for your work and your group's work. And I want to thank the other groups, League of Women Voters. Carly, your group is great, and I appreciate you both for all your efforts. Thank you.
Now we're going to turn the floor over to you all. I do want to say real quick, though, because, we end up, because of the discussion we're having, often sounding negative and hopeless. But there are actions over the last few years that have given us hope. Senator Henson was awarded from our organization 2 years ago for creating the only discussion down at the General Assembly during the 2011 session on ethics reform. He had to do a little bit of acrobatics with an amendment to try to force it in there. His attempt got ruled as not germane, which apparently is in the eye of the beholder or the eye of the lieutenant governor, and didn't get a vote, didn't get anything on it besides a discussion. So I mean, he was able to push it forward more so than anybody else had. Senator McCoon also has been awarded by our group for standing up within his party and really taking this on, and has taken some political lumps for it. But I think, he takes the lumps maybe from people in the party down at the Gold Dome, but doesn't take lumps from the constituents or people who are out there paying attention and understanding what's going on. So that's why we want to hear from you all, because it seems like you have your head straighter than anybody down that way, except for those with us tonight. So we wanted to give you the opportunity to give your input. So it's always hard, I've done 9 of these now, it's always hard to get the first question, but once we get the first question, they start rolling. So, wow, look at that, that was easy. Mr. Waltz.
I wanted to ask about per diem and expense accounts. Right now, the oversight of per diem and how people spend their expense accounts and whether newsletters are political or not are governed by rules in the House and Senate and not by legislation. Obviously, we've seen some abuses of that. I've spent some time down there looking at a number of these accounts. Sometimes I would see, say, house expenditures that had been duplicated by a member's political campaign. And, you know, people in the office would say, what did you find? And I'd show them. The point is that they would not know, and they would not have a way of knowing when somebody turned in their expenses that 6 months down the road, they might also disclose a campaign expenditure for the same thing. A lot of it's on the honor system. The Senate Rules Committee has allegedly been, you know, tasked with auditing these. In the House, is it Information and Audits Committee has been charged with overseeing those, chaired by somebody who receives donations from everybody in leadership, campaign donations. So I guess what I'm wondering is, have you all talked about, or how would you see there might be some sort of improved oversight over that aspect?
Well, I'll start. First of all, I've had some discussions with people that, A, some people aren't even that in tune to what the rules are, even the members of our own body. One legislator didn't realize you could get per diem unless you were here. Unless you were coming to the Capitol, he thought you could only get per diem if you come to the Capitol, and then you know that you find out people are getting per diems for just going to a meeting, not staying overnight, going 20 miles from their home. So I think that definitely we need to look and create a guideline for legislators to go to on per diem uses and make sure everybody is aware and knowledgeable and has no excuses. I do think, you know, I have not discussed it, and your issues right there that you brought up, I think it would be good if we had some enforceable penalties for violating the use of per diem or other actions. There could be a criminal law broken if somebody has taken state money for something and then is reimbursing out of their campaign. And certainly I would look into it if there's not a statute that could apply to that. So, you know, I would look forward to sitting down with you, talking to you some of the abuses that you feel may be there. There's no doubt in my mind that the Senate Subcommittee of Rules that was supposed to audit and review these uses of per diem was not in effect and not being used, and that some other alternative method should be used. So we can look at that in this session. I'm sure Senator McCune and I would be happy to meet with Lieutenant Governor and see if he can work with us to try to find a way that that's effectively managed, and possibly, you know, bring some state statutes in that would create more of an atmosphere of urgency to members of the legislative body to investigate what's appropriate and not appropriate. So I appreciate that. Senator McCune?
go ahead and just ask the next question.
Okay.
I don't disagree with anything Senator Henson said, other than I think we might be better served in going forward to look at how we do compensation at the General Assembly. I mean, Senator Henson's first comment, I think, is well taken, that even members of the General Assembly, members who have been around much longer than I have expressed a good deal of confusion about the policies. And we might be better off collapsing all of this into a salary, getting rid of per diem altogether, getting rid of the expense account, and then, you know, you kind of eliminate a lot of these issues, I think, if you do that. But having said that, short of that, I would certainly be open to a discussion on how we tighten the current law to do that. I just I wonder if we wind up spending a lot of additional resources that we could avoid altogether just by changing the model of how we compensate folks in the first place. And we'll take another question if there are any.
Let me just say one thing. That's devils and details, and I'm willing to work with Senator McCune on this. For instance, there have been discussions that maybe the 7200 that we get for office expense that some people use for a mailing. Some people don't know they could even do a newsletter out of it. And they pay for maybe office help during the session or some office equipment they don't have. Should be rolled into people's salaries, and because the fiscal office, even looking at those and trying to manage them, probably spend more money than we give them the $7,200. Just keep an eye on them. Having you come in and pull files all the time probably run up the cost, which is a good thing. But you know, I have a concern about that because people do that sometimes, connect with their constituents and do things that are for the constituents. And so rolling in your salary, you're not gonna maybe take money out of your own bank account to do that newsletter. So I'd rather see regulation where we do get some. Also, sometimes you roll in a salary, then 5 years later, everybody thinks, oh, well, I need a little budget to buy something for my office. And you find out, you know, okay, we got a raise 5 years from now, you're back to the same thing. There was a need for it. That need needs to be addressed, needs to be defined, needs to be regulated, and enforcement needs to be there for it. That's the way I feel this time.
Another question?
Yes, sir.
Well, I would just follow that up. You've got these days, you can put things on the web and really, you know, multiply the people that could actually do something for you. If you standardize the format of expenses and posted it, then all of a sudden, you'd say, what was that, 1.2 million voters who could potentially put it up, do a little Facebook blog? You know, why? You're never going to get much more than your 12 staff. So why not use the voters, the same people that you say are concerned about it, and then have them have some way for them to just funnel the information to somebody that could actually look at it and see if it's a conflict or if it's just normal everyday expenses.
Well, I think that's a point well taken. I mean, as far as the per diem paperwork or the expense account paperwork is concerned, and we certainly do that now with the campaign disclosure. So it would just be a matter of standardizing the forms and you know, getting the staff to put it out on the internet.
Eric.
Isn't this a huge public relations issue that Georgia has with the entire country? I mean, we're dead last, 50 out of 50. And what is it going to take for these guys to wake up and realize that that is hurting our business? It's hurting our economy, it's hurting our government, it's hurting our legitimacy in the country. And that seems to be a huge issue. I mean, we're number one in corruption, let's face it. And how are we going to bring that issue out? And you know, is that pressure that we can use to get some reform?
Well, I think a couple of things. First of all, I would say that people are waking up, and to the point that was made earlier about not trying to sound 100% gloom and doom. I will applaud the Lieutenant Governor for appointing the study committee. For making sure that that we got together at the biennial and started talking about this issue. I know it's something that is that he is very aware of the problem and wants us to address it, and I've had many conversations with him about it. I think it's also telling that when you look at the leadership in the Senate, I know I made this point once before, but I do think it bears repeating, that the top three members of the leadership in the majority party were willing to sign on to an ethics reform bill that, quite frankly, there was a great deal of pressure being applied not to publicly affiliate oneself with. So I think in that sense that people are waking up to it. I think that the Ethics Alliance has done a magnificent job since we adjourned of keeping this issue at the forefront of voters' minds, both through the referendum that was offered, whether you took a Republican ballot or a Democratic ballot, the bus tour that William referenced, the series of town hall meetings that have taken place in every corner of the state. I mean, no one can say that this is not an issue where they've had the opportunity to be directly confronted with it, to hear about it, and to move forward on it. I do think that there are other ways we can leverage the issue, as you say,
For example, does someone from an economic development standpoint want to come to a state that bears that kind of designation? And I think that's another argument that we ought to be making. And I don't think it's one that I've heard. So I think that's something that is that's well said. And I'll turn it over to Senator Henson if he's got some more comments.
And staff there. I mean, I'll just say briefly, I think the fact that we've ranked 50th is a good tool for us to force this issue. A gift cap ban would knock us too far up the chain. We have a lot of bigger issues. One mentioned with the revolving door, we talked about that for other elected officials and for appointed officials and for et cetera. But there's a lot of things that, you know, stricter enforcement of other types of laws that we need to force to make improvements on. And really one reason I bothered to stand up, because Senator McCoon responded well, was a lot of people in this room, and I realized that when I realized you know, you've been through everybody's per diem. I mean, I haven't gone through everybody else's, you know, per diem. I mean, a lot of people in this room really have knowledge that I hope you will share with Senator McCoon and myself at some point on some of the things that we maybe could do to address some of these concerns, both from the legislature, executive branch issues that you've seen that you think, you know, laws can be made to improve it. So, you know, I just want to thank you for that.
Anyone else?
Is there a chance that, I mean, really, the elephant in the room is that this is the Senate on one side of the issue, and at least the leadership of the House seems to be, from what I'm hearing here, on the other side of this issue. What are the chances that that this could affect other legislation? What's really at stake here, and how do you get past what seems to be an intransigent House leadership and actually get something done with on this? I mean, what can you bring to bear on your colleagues on the other side of the House?
Well, at least as to the gift limit question, we had this discussion earlier in the week at our study committee meeting, and Senator Henson made the point, which I agree with, that ideally, you know, we want a legislative solution. We want something that's going to be in the code. But something that the Senate does have complete control over are our rules that govern the Senate. And if it appears that, you know, we're not going to be able to get that legislative fix, or at least to begin with, to lay a marker down, we can adopt language to limit the members of the Senate. We can't bind the House with a Senate rule, but I think it's certainly a way to lay a marker down and show that we're leading the way on this issue. So that's what I would say to that.
My only response
is I am fairly hopeful that something will pass as far as a gift cap, at the very least. My concern is that in the process of getting something done, that it doesn't have the full protections that Senator McCoon is talking about today, that loopholes are worked into it, and that sort of thing. That's why the main thing that is important here is that each of you watch this issue closely and report back to the public on what's really being done, and not let some minor movement in the positive direction curtail the interest or excitement for true ethics reform. So, you know, political gamesmanship and one-upsmanship at different parties are always going on. I'm sure if Senator McCoon wants $100, my party's probably going to want $90 gift cap. But regardless of the politics involved, I think you'll be able to see the product. And with honest representation from a few members of the legislature, I hope you'll report out there what would need to be done in the future. Because I'm sure no matter what happens in the session, there'll be work to be done. You know, I'm confident we'll move in the right direction, but one never knows. What pressure we had to bring to bear on the House is very, you know, much like any pressure. Public awareness, the Senator McCoon's been to 9 of these meetings, William Perry's been to all of them, I'm sure. And, you know, that public awareness is going to be important. And as we go through the session with when the Democrat caucus members drop their bills and Senator McCoon drops his bills, these other people are dropping the bills, that is pressure, and that is going to affect them. When the lieutenant governor goes out as he, I'm sure he will at various points, and speaks to groups and say we need to do something. That's going to be pressure on the House. And in fact, at one point, I think the Speaker said that he was receptive to something as far as gifts. So, you know, I think the pressure is there, and it will build as the session develops.
I'm going to jump on in on this real quick, Pete. I think it's a great question. And not being an elected member of the General Assembly, I can call out names. Speaker David Ralston continuously fought us during the last session, said what we were doing is a gimmick. He said that the people of Georgia are the people that he trusts, and he doesn't understand why Common Cause and the Tea Party doesn't trust Georgians because we want to limit caps on gifts. But the momentum that we created, the momentum that so many of you helped create, now had the Speaker come out, and he won't follow up much on it, but he came out and said that if we're going to do it, he supports, as he said, a full gift ban. And so I think that tells you what the momentum can do and why I think this time is going to be different. And he may be playing a game. That's purely speculation on my end. He saw that the leadership in the Senate of both parties were signing on and saying we're going to do something about it. So maybe he's trying to one-up them and think that, aha, I'll show them, I'll send them this and make them the bad guy. And look at them stepping forward and saying, you can paint us as a bad guy, but we're going to do what's right. So the fact that the conversation has been forced, and the Speaker says no matter what he does, we will never give him credit. I'll give him credit for calling for a gift ban. I applauded him for calling a gift ban. But now the call has been made, so let's see the action. It's time to step up and make sure that it's done right. So these two guys are helping lead that effort, so I'm glad we're getting there. Other questions? Yes, sir.
I think the gift cap is a terrific idea, but overall, are campaign contributions the real currency of political influence?
I'll let you take that. I've taken a few in my life, but didn't succeed.
Yeah.
There's no doubt.
I mean, there's a big issue, and I think one of the thing opponents of this say, you know, you're talking about gift cap, gift ban, but you can still give somebody a $2,500 check for their campaign. The way you fix something is comprehensively look at it. There is no doubt that there is influence in political campaign contributions. People are affected by different things, and associations with people, affects how people behave. So we address one thing at a time. One thing is having tickets to go to events or trips to faraway lands with legislators and spending time with them can affect them and maybe affect their judgment. Not all people, actually probably very few of the General Assembly would be affected, but it can, and it certainly affects perception. So we need to look at that and we need to address it. As we did when we knocked the campaign contributions from unlimited to $3,500 and $2,500. So we will need to look at it piece by piece and try to improve things. I think it will improve things if we don't let somebody pay for a legislator to go overseas on a trip if there's on a junket. I think it improves things if we don't buy $800 concert tickets to a legislator, which has happened in the past. Is there still cause for concern? I think there'll always be cause for concern for politics, but we need to just move in the right direction. Also, quite frankly, you know, there's one little protection, as when people do get the money in the campaign account, politics and being reelected is real important. So they don't tend to buy the tickets and things like that out of the campaign. They save it for the news mailings and running the campaign. So at least, hopefully, that wouldn't be abused in that way.
That's a great point.
You know, so I don't know if that answers the question. It's a move in the right direction. Until them, or unless, and I'm not proposing this, you know, the public wants to fully fund, you know, campaign stuff, there'll always be that. And fully funding public financing also has its problems. You know, getting a financing for the campaigns weeds out, you know, people, you know, who maybe shouldn't run it. You know, public financing, you know, a lot of people run who maybe don't have a chance, taking public monies to promote themselves, et cetera. So, you know, needs to be evaluated. But
the only thing I would add to that, and Senator Henson pretty much said it, but, you know, a gift, something that somebody personally consumes, in my view, is fundamentally different from a contribution to a campaign, which is, in essence, a communication machine. I mean, it's designed to broadcast a message. I mean, you know, we all use campaign funds, as Senator Henson said, to communicate a political message. And so I think those things are fundamentally different. I do think what is so corrosive to public confidence right now is when people open the newspaper and see the kind of trips Senator Henson talks about, the kinds of things that really have absolutely no connection to the public policymaking process at all. And I think if we can get a hold of those things, and more importantly, show the public that, you know, we all get together as elected officials and place that limitation on ourselves, then I think that we can send a very clear message that we're getting serious about delivering open, honest, transparent government and get on with the other issues that, you know, that I referenced earlier.
One thing I'll quickly add to that is I feel safer about the campaign contributions and their influence, because a campaign contribution is an expression of political will. You're saying with that campaign contribution what you believe in and who you believe in. And more importantly, the onus of reporting that is on the candidate, not on the person writing the check. So I feel more comfortable with them putting their political reputation on the line for making sure that's reported properly and handled in that way. And compared to our current system, there is a limit on it. I can only give Senator McCoon and Senator Henson $2,500 each. Well, don't get any ideas, because I can't give you $2,500 each. But there's a limit on it, versus what we've got right now. It's completely unlimited by the lobbyist gifts. Other questions?
If you do get a $100 gift cap, how is the University System of Georgia going to lobby the legislature if they can no longer give Georgia Bulldogs tickets to anybody who asks?
They'll have to get creative. The concept behind this is that you got to argue the ideas over the influence of dollars.
The reason I mention that is I haven't done anything definitive lately, but when I looked at this once before, the largest single giver of $100 gifts was the university system. You know, tickets left and right, and they fly various members of the House out to Southern California every year to look at the Georgia State University telescope on Mount Palomar.
Nobody's even offered that to me.
I know, it's just the House, apparently. You go back to the House. But anyway, I just wondered if you or Senator McCoon, maybe, or Senator Henson had engaged anybody at the university system to say, look, this is going to be a thing for you. If we get this cap, let's work together on it.
I have not engaged anybody at the university system. I will say, we had this conversation in the meeting the other day about what if you get a football ticket and it's more than $100? And I think it was Senator Henson that said this, maybe it was somebody else. He said, pay for it. So I mean, I think that would be my response if it's over that limitation. I did want to add one other, I think, important distinction under Georgia law about how campaign contributions and gifts are treated, that I think is an important distinction to make. You can't give a campaign contribution while we're in session. You know, you can't go to a committee meeting, go have a fundraiser, then go vote on something on the floor. We don't allow that in Georgia. But somebody can take you quail hunting over the weekend before a vote if they wanted to. So, you know, I think that's also an important distinction for us to make.
Got about 5 minutes left. Did you want
to? No, I basically think, as far as, I wouldn't worry about the University of Georgia or Georgia Tech if somehow they're precluded from giving numerous tickets. You know, I and most legislators do. I'm an alumni of the University of Georgia. I don't support the University of Georgia because I'm an alumni. I don't you know, not support Georgia Tech or technical schools because I didn't go there. I support them because of what they do for my constituency. And those tickets shouldn't affect that. So, as Senator McCoon said, we were meeting the other day and talking about the SEC championship game. I paid for my tickets. And, you know, let them pay for the ticket. So,
we've got about 5 minutes left. Kyle.
First of all, I got an email the other day offering to sell me tickets to the Georgia basketball from the University of Georgia for $5. So you can go to all the basketball games, I think. About the funding piece, what's the percentage? What does that come out to in real dollars? What does that compare to now? What does that compare to from, I think you said, 06, 07 when funding was cut? What are we talking about in real terms?
The proposal that I've pre-filed, and as Senator Henson mentioned, Senator Jackson had a proposal, I think, with a slightly different figure, and I'm definitely willing to engage in some dialogue on what an appropriate level is. The level that I had placed in the pre-filed resolution is 0.00025%, which I believe works out to be about $4.9 million. And that is significantly more than what they are currently receiving. I believe they are receiving something less than $2 million as of the last budget. I think I've got that right.
Do you have anything about being two-thirds of your dues?
I think it tracked. I think it tracked the language in that legislation about requiring a supermajority to
reduce it.
And it would make a lot of headlines. You know, the exact figure, 0.025 or what, I mean, we would go in a session, we calculate with the budget office, you know, where we're at, what is needed. Hopefully we would, I'm sure Senator McCoon and myself would work for an increase in the budget because they have been sorely impacted by the recent budget cuts and make sure they had a fair amount. So, you know, he stated his amount, which would be an increase and, you know, reasonable amount. We're willing to talk to people about that amount to try to get to the right number. The more important thing is that there's a protection that it wouldn't just a majority vote each session, it could be decreased, like we said, the budget each session, and that it would be in stone. The governor wouldn't withhold the money on a whim like he can some agencies, and that the legislature, by just a majority vote, couldn't would reduce it because you angered some powerful member of the leadership in one house or the other.
Anyone else? Any other questions? All right. That means we've been comprehensive, so thank you very much. I want to keep it going because I want to give all of you a round of applause for helping us do this because really it is an important step forward to have these discussions and most importantly to have input in it. And as both of them said, you know, not just Jim, not just Kyle, not just our friends in the media, but anyone who has further thoughts about this stuff, please step forward, share your thoughts with us. It's going to be a big moving process, but thankfully we can describe it as moving for once. So thank you all very much for being here. We really appreciate it.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll say it. You say it.
I like them.
Are they using the video on YouTube? So the
I know that.
I love NPR.